Hello, I am Dr. Shabbir Ali, Head of the Department, LLM and Research Coordinator, VM Salgaonkar College of Law, Panji, Goa. Today I am going to present about consumers and access to justice. Today's structure of presentation is, we are going to look into interaction, objectives of this presentation. We are referring to development of consumer movement and consumer laws during British period as well as after independence. We are going to look into the most important enactment, Consumer Protection Act 1986, and we are going to discuss about a brief idea about Competition Act of 2002. Every one of us is a consumer from cradle to the grave, irrespective of whether he is a, irrespective of the nature, rank, nation, creed, caste, sex. Every one of us is a consumer. Once we buy goods or services, we are treated as consumers. When I purchase a TV, or when I purchase clothes, when I purchase car, I could be consumer of goods. When I open bank account, insurance policy, dry cleaning, transport, I could be consumer of services. The learning objectives for this module is to verify the development of consumer enactments during the British era, to find out the law evolved after independence to protect the interest of consumers, to analyze the objectives and remedies available to consumers under the Consumer Protection Act 1986, to examine the hierarchy of authorities set up under the Consumer Protection Act to provide consumer justice, to provide a brief idea about competition enactment to deal with consumers. Consumer protection has been a matter of concern from ancient times. In the early days, commercial activities are governed by principles of laissez-faire, means free market. In free market, state does not interfere, or the state interference is limited. The market is governed by absolute economic freedom. So, the seller is having freedom to sell his goods and provide services to the public. In the marketplace, a new doctrine is evolved known as caveat emptor, means let the buyer beware. Means here, the burden is on the buyer. When he is purchasing goods, he should know what kind of goods he is purchasing, what is the nature of the goods and what is the quality of the goods, and seller does not come in picture if you refer to the maxim caveat emptor. Due to development of technology, new methods of sale, services and advertisement, consumer is a victim and he is exploited and is screwed in the marketplace. He is not aware about the quality and the quantity of goods he purchased in the marketplace. Consumer choice is unlimited because various range of goods are available in the market, and he is having a limited, unlimited choice. He can select any kind of goods what he likes. Consumer is helpless and is not aware about the quality of the goods. The most important is, because of development of technology and new methods of sale and services, consumer is helpless and is not aware the quality of the goods he is purchasing in the marketplace. To protect the interest, a new concept evolved, that is caveat vendetur, means let the seller beware. When the seller is going to sell the product, it is his duty to inform the consumer what kind of products they want, or what quality of the products they want, and what is the price. Everything has to be informed by seller, and the burden is imposed on the seller instead of buyer. And there is a saying that consumer is the king in the marketplace, but there are different loopholes, or people commented on this concept. Consumer protection in India, we can divide into two important stages: British period and after independence. During the British period, British made various enactments from time to time to protect the interest of consumers in the marketplace. The various enactments are Indian Penal Code 1860, Indian Contract Act 1872, Dangerous Drugs Act 1930, Sale of Goods Act 1930, Drugs and Cosmetics Act of 1940. So, these are the various laws which are made by the British, but out of these, the most important enactment which tried to protect the interest of consumers are three: Indian Penal Code 1860, Law of Contract, and Law of Torts. Let us look into these enactments one by one, and let us look into the loopholes under these enactments. The first enactment is Indian Penal Code 1860. This act was enacted by the British in their 1860. Even though this is a old enactment, still the enactment is applicable in India, and this act also consists of various provisions which deals with consumer and consumer interest. So, for example, adulteration of food, adulteration of drugs and adulteration of drinks. Any person adulterates any drink, drug or food, the person can avail the remedy under IPC by approaching a criminal court. Section 272 to 276 deals with these three concepts. Weights and measures also comes under IPC. Besides misleading description and any kind of public nuisance, the remedy is available under Indian Penal Code. In order to avail the remedy, the consumer has to approach a criminal court. The most important remedy the criminal court can provide is imprisonment of the offender, as well as they can impose fine on the offender. But most of the victims are not in a position to approach the criminal court due to various loopholes available under penal law, because the remedy is restricted and imprisonment is very narrow or very limited. And the next reason is illiteracy, poverty and incompetence. So many people are not competent, they are not aware about where to go and which court to approach and how to file the case and how to argue the case. The next important enactment is law of contract. And this law of contract provides rights and duties of seller as well as buyer. And the rights and duties of seller and buyer are incorporated under the Contract Act of 1872. Again, this law was made by the British. And this act deals with basic principles which when an agreement becomes a contract, and it deals with act, the contract act is limited because of privity of contract. Privity of contract means the person is affected and the person is a victim alone can approach the court. A third party cannot avail the remedy under law of contract. Though the act is important from consumer point of view, it consists of the lacuna, a third party cannot approach the court. The law of contract 1872 consists of Sale of Goods Act, but this Sale of Goods Act was again removed from Contract Act and they brought a new enactment to protect the interest of buyer, and the act is known as Sale of Goods Act of 1930. This act regulates sale of goods. This act changed the concept of caveat emptor into caveat vendetor, and it says that the caveat vendetor says that let the seller beware about the quantity and quality of goods which he sells to the buyer. And under this act, liability is on the seller to offer marketable quality of goods. This act also failed to provide remedy to the buyer because of various lacuna or exceptions. Under the law of contract, the consumer can avail the most important remedies in case of breach of contract or loss of goods or loss of services. Compensation or damages, and whatever loss is suffered, he can claim damages from the court, or the person can request the court to grant injunction informing the offender to do or not to do a particular act, or he can avail specific relief under the specific relief act informing the court to rectify the defect in the goods or to replace the goods. Besides this, the consumer cannot avail any other remedy if he approach the remedy under law of contract. The next important act is law of torts. This law of torts is nothing but common law remedy or a remedy available under law of torts. This is the oldest law available in India, which was brought during the British period. Under this law of torts, it is unwritten law, and mostly it depends upon judicial pronouncement. Under this tort law, duty is imposed on the manufacturer to take care when he is selling the goods or when he is selling the products. One of the most important cases, Donago versus Stevenson, in this case, the court imposed liability on any one of the persons or two or more persons which are mentioned in the slide. So, consumer can file a complaint against manufacturer, supplier, or he can file a complaint against retailer or importer. Or he can file a complaint against two or three persons. He can file a complaint against manufacturer, supplier, retailer, or he can file against one or two persons. After independence, the Indian Parliament made various enactments, and these enactments we can divide into three important stages. Enactments made during 1950s, 1955, enactments made from 1969 to 1980. If you refer during 1950s, the most important enactments are Banking Regulation Act, Industrial Development Act and Regulation Act. During 1955, Prevention of Food Adulteration Act, And as you have seen under IPC, IPC also deals with food adulteration, food, drink and drug adulteration. You need to prohibit adulteration of any food, a new enactment came and a person can approach under the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act. The next act is Essential Commodities Act and ISI Certification Marks Act. These enactments which are made during 1955. During 1960 to 1980, Indian Parliament made the most important two enactments. One is Monopolies Restrictive Trade Practice Act, that is MRTP Act 1969, and National Security Act. These are the two important enactments made after independence till 1980. Even though these enactments are made, even consumer is not availing appropriate remedy under this campaign because of certain drawbacks. The drawbacks are no specific law to deal with consumer interest and consumer protection. All the laws which are available before 1986, the laws are in piecemeal. And when the consumer approached the court, it was time consuming. And consumer was moving from pillar to post without getting an appropriate remedy before any court. You know, to avoid all these drawbacks, the Indian Parliament made one of the most important amendment in their 1986, that is Consumer Protection Act of 1986. The main objective of this act are to provide simple, speedy and inexpensive justice. Simple means the court should follow simple procedure and procedure should not be complicated. And they should not look into CPC when deciding the matters or the complaint before the consumer forums. The justice should be speedy because every complaint has to be disposed within 3 months or 5 months in case the goods requires testing. That's why the justice is speedy if the person approaches the consumer forums, and justice is inexpensive. That means the consumer does not require to spend more money. He can argue the case by himself, and even court fee was restricted as it was limited. But recently, the government also introduced the limited court fee and other expenses in case of consumer forums. This act, that is the Consumer Protection Act of 1986, consists of 31 sections and 4 chapters. And this act mentions about establishment of councils. Councils are set up at central as well as state level to create awareness among the consumers about their rights and their remedies and reliefs available under this act. Central Consumer Protection Council and State Consumer Protection Councils are established under this act. These councils are headed by Minister in charge of consumer affairs in case of Central Consumer Protection Council and Minister in charge of state with respect to state consumer protection councils. And this enactment covers all kinds of sectors, public sector, private sector and corporate sector. This act applies to all kinds of goods and services. This act provides penal provisions for non-compliance of its orders. Any person disobeys or fails to obey the orders or contempt of court, the consumer forum can imprison the person or they can arrest and they can imprison the person. This act provides simple, speedy and expensive redressal to the consumers. This act awards relief and compensation wherever appropriate to the consumers. This act talks about consumer rights. Various rights are incorporated under this enactment. The first right is right to be protected against marketing of goods which are hazardous to life and property of the persons. Right to be informed about quality, quantity, policy, purity, standards and price of goods to protect the consumer against any kind of unfair trade practice. Right to be assured with respect to wherever possible access to variety of goods of in the competitive prices. Right to be heard with respect to his complaint before the appropriate consumer forums. Right to seek redressal against untrade practices as well as unscrupulous exploitation of consumers. Right to consumer education is also one of the most important rights available under this act. Besides these 6 rights, in the year 1993 and 2002, the Indian Parliament added 2 more rights. Right to be protected from unfair trade practice as defined under section 36A of MRTP Act 1969. What is meant by unfair trade practice? For example, advertisement with respect to new ceramics, sun silk extract treatment shampoo, stating that it not only repairs but also rebuild damaged hair back to life, was treated as unfair trade practice. And even I have seen other advertisement like if a person takes Complan, he becomes taller and there will improve in the growth. All these things come under the category unfair trade practice. Production from spurious goods are offering such goods for sale or adopting deceptive practices while providing services to the consumer. Again, it comes as a right available under the Consumer Protection Act 1986. This act defines consumer. Section 21D of the act defines the term consumer. The term consumer includes any person who purchases goods or hire services for consideration. Generally, you can say consumer includes buyer of the goods, person who uses the goods, or person who hires services, or beneficiary of service, and buyer for earning his livelihood. All these categories comes within meaning consumer. Just you can go through the slide defines the term consumer. But this act also says there are certain categories of persons does not fit within meaning consumer. Those categories includes buyer of the goods without consideration, hires services without consideration, services free of charge, contract of personal service, buyer for resale, and buyer for commercial purpose. All these persons does not fit with the meaning consumer for the purpose of Consumer Protection Act. Complainant means a person who can complain being a consumer, he can come before the appropriate forum. Voluntary consumer association or organization, state or central government can make a complaint before the appropriate consumer forum. One or more consumers having the same interest. Lastly, legalists as well as representatives, all these people can approach the consumer forums to avail appropriate remedy with respect to consumer justice. What is complaint? Complaint means, or the term complaint includes any person who has suffered with respect to unfair trade practice, defect in goods, deficiency in service, where a person charges excess price charged above MRP. Again, the person is a consumer and can approach the consumer forum, can avail appropriate remedy. Hazard services, hazardous goods without safety to the for health and life of consumers. Again, he can approach the consumer forum and he can lodge a complaint. And this, under this enactment, the government has set up three-tier quasi-judicial authorities to deal with consumer complaints. And these authorities are set up at district level, state level, and national level. District level, where it is known as District Consumer Redressal Forum. State level, it is known as State Consumer Redressal Commission. At the national level, National Consumer Redressal Commission. Where to lodge a complaint? Before which authority the person can lodge a complaint to redress consumer grievance? This act deals with pecuniary jurisdiction with respect to goods or services, where a person avails purchase goods or services, and whenever there is a deficiency or defect in goods, where the value of the goods is below 20 lakhs, the person can approach consumer dispute redressal forum at the district level. Where the value of the goods is above 20 lakhs and up to 1 crore, the person has to approach consumer dispute redressal commission, that is at the state level. And where the value of the goods or services is above 1 crore, the person has to approach national commission. From this national commission, appeal can be preferred to Supreme Court. What are the remedies or the reliefs a consumer can avail under the Consumer Protection Act 1986? The reliefs are removal of the defect in the goods or services. They remove any kind of defect in the goods or services, they are going to remove the defect. The second relief is replacement of goods. They can take back the goods and they can give a new goods or products to the consumer. Refund of the price paid. if the consumer is not happy with the goods and he can claim the refund of the price, award compensation for loss or damage suffered by the consumer, discontinuance of unfair trade practice or restrictive trade practice, or direct not to repeat the same practice. The forum can award the consumer, or they can inform the seller not to repeat the same practice with respect to unfair trade practice or restrictive trade practice, not offer dangerous food for sale. Besides this, the court can also, the forum also can award relief like withdrawal of hazardous or spurious goods from being offered for sale, tissue character advertisement to neutralize the effect of misleading advertisement at the cost of opposite party responsible for issuing such misleading advertisement, award the cost to the parties as per appropriate relief. So, after going through the Consumer Protection Act, which was the most important amendment which was made in the year 1986 to deal with consumer interest and it provides consumer justice. Once again, the Indian Parliament made a new enactment in the year 2002, and this enactment was made in order to deal with changing conditions in the marketplace. So, because of LPG is a concept which came in the marketplace, that is liberalization, privatization and globalization. To cope with the changing conditions in the marketplace, the Indian Parliament introduced the new enactment, the Competition Act of 2002. This enactment replaced the MRTP Act of 1969. Further, this act dissolves MRTP Commission, which was set up under the Act of 1969. The main aim of the Act is to provide free and fair competition in India and to protect the interest of Indian consumers. The Act provides for establishment of regulatory authority known as Competition Commission of India, CCI. The important functions of this enactment includes competition advocacy, creating awareness and imparting training on competition issues. The Act mainly deals with prohibition of anti-competition agreement. If any agreement between the trade unions and any association, which is known as anti-competition agreement, is prohibited under this enactment. This Act also deals with prevention of abuse of dominance. Nobody can control the power in one hand, or nobody can control the marketplace. It is prohibited under this enactment, that is Competition Act of 2002. This Act also regulates combination or merger or amalgamation and acquisition of two or more companies or industries. They cannot amalgamate and they cannot retain monopoly in the marketplace. The Competition Commission mainly inquires into three kinds of violations. The violations are, they can act sumo to on its own on the basis of information or knowledge. They can act on the information received by them, or they can act on receipt of a reference from central or state government or any statutory authority. Who can provide information to this commission under Competition Act of 2002? Four categories of person can provide information under this Act. Any individual, including a company, corporation or any artificial or juridical person. The second category, local authorities or body incorporated outside India. Any consumer, again you have seen the term consumer as per Consumer Protection Act 1996. The lastly, intermediate customers, all these persons can provide information to Competition Commission of India under the Competition Act of 2002. So, what are the problems we are facing with respect to consumers in India? There are number of laws to protect the rights of consumers, but most of the enactment fail to provide consumer justice because of lack of awareness among the consumers. Consumers are not educated and they are not aware about their rights under this Act. Besides this, consumers feel that the remedy available under this Act is complex, lengthy legal process, and they are not in a position to approach the court or the forums. Consumer education assumes priority in generating awareness among the people in general and consumers in particular. Consumers deals with laws used as introduce unintended advertising, advocacy, avoid products with drugs, food safety, choosing healthy behavior, environmental protection, choosing healthy environment, labels, seeking service information, all these are the areas where consumers are affected. As I was mentioned earlier, as well as I showed in the slide, the term consumer as per section 21D of the Act includes buyer of goods. A person goes to market and purchases any goods or products. He is known as consumer for the purpose of Consumer Protection Act. Or any person uses the goods with his consent. The person who is the user of the goods also treated as a consumer for the purpose of Consumer Protection Act. The second category is services. The person who hires services. The services includes any kind of service, transport, insurance, banking, entertainment, all services comes with the meaning service for the purpose of Consumer Protection Act. Besides that, beneficiary of service, any person who is benefiting because of the service, he is also comes with the meaning consumer for the purpose of this act. Buyer for earning his livelihood, any person purchases goods only for his earnings. So, for example, if a person purchases a saving machine mainly for his livelihood, the person also known as consumer for the purpose of this enactment. And any person purchases any goods for his main livelihood and service also, it is the duty of the person, other person to provide service, he comes with the meaning consumer for the purpose of this enactment. This act mentions about the term consumer does not include various categories as per the slide. The first one is buy the goods without consideration. If any person gives any goods or products without any payment, the person is not treated as a consumer as per this enactment. Any person hires service without making payment or without any consideration, that person also does not come with a meaning consumer. Next, person avails service free of charge. For example, if a person goes to government hospital and avails services from government hospital without making any payment, then the person is not a consumer as per this enactment. So, the issue came before the court regarding government hospital, whether they comes with a meaning consumer or not. In many judgments, the court held that without payment of fees, if the person avails service from government hospital, the person does not come with a meaning consumer for the purpose of this enactment. Contact of personal service, again the person does not come with a meaning consumer for this act. There are two different things, one is contact of service and contract for service. Contact of service, for example, master and servant relationship. In this case, servant cannot file a case against the master saying that he is a consumer of service. But contact for service, the person can avail the relief before the consumer forum as a consumer. Contact for service means, for example, if a person goes to a person who approaches advocate as a client and he takes the advice of the advocate or he requests the advocate to file a case on his behalf, and it is duty of the advocate to provide service, it is contract for service. Buyer for resale, whenever a person purchases any goods and he try to resell the goods in the market, again he is not treated as a consumer for the purpose of this enactment. Buyer for commercial purpose, any person purchases the goods in bulk and again he is going to sell the goods in the market for commercial purpose, the person is not treated as a consumer for the purpose of this act. Any person uses or purchases the goods and he sells the goods for commercial activity, he is not treated as a consumer for this act. Already we discussed about complaint under this act and have seen who is the complainant who can file a complaint under Consumer Protection Act. So, I discuss about the drawbacks under this act and what is the most important you have to see with respect to this act is the concern for consumer justice in India. Thank you.